Let's bow our heads. Lord, as we talk to you in prayer, thank you for your blessing on this afternoon's presentation. May your Holy Spirit rest upon Dr. Bigger as he shares with us further of his experience, him and Barbara, and applies some of this to forgiveness and challenges us in our faith walk with you to forgive. Thank you, Lord, that you reach down into the depth of our hatred, into the depth of our feelings of revenge, into the depth of our feelings of hurt and pain. And you find us there, crumbled up, and you seek to lift us. You invite us. Your hands are outstretched as you say, come to me, you that are heavy burdened and laden, and I will give you rest. Do that for us today. Amen.
I want to tell you what we intend to tell you so that when we finish, you will make sure that we've told you what we were going to say. That suggests that there's a possibility as we start telling the story. You saw last night how we tend to relive some of that, and I don't want to leave out what in our minds seem to be some key things that have been helpful to us and hopefully can be helpful to you. So we intend to start with the kind of the sequel to what happened to Shannon and our initial responses to that. Then we'll cover some theoretical descriptions of what forgiveness is, what forgiveness isn't, how it works, how it doesn't work, etc. I want to be sure to include as part of that two particular features. One is a little discussion about the Lord's Prayer and whether or not once you forgive, it's all taken care of. And it's all over and in the past.
He said I didn't talk very much last night, so I get to start today. How many of you were here last night? Oh, most everybody, so you know the story. We didn't talk too much about our experience with Anthony himself. Because he pled guilty to these three charges, you know, first-degree murder, attempted sex offense, and armed robbery, I was baffled why anybody would plead guilty to such heinous crimes. And, of course, as Darold said, Maryland has the death penalty, and so apparently he didn't want to lose his life and decided that that was a good way to plead. His mother did contact us. She went through a reporter who asked if she could talk to us. This is before we knew whether or not there was going to be a trial. And one Sabbath morning, as we got ready to head out for Sabbath school and church, the phone rang, and it is Mrs. Robinson. I wasn't sure I wanted to talk to this lady, and I don't think I did, actually. You talked to her. Hillary, our surviving daughter, did not want to. So Darold did talk to her, and my takeaway from that, and I think yours, is that what she really wanted us to know, is that her son was a good boy. He had gone to Sunday school, and he had just fallen in with the wrong crowd. And she wanted us to know that she knew Darold was, she called him a preacher. And that surprised me, because in the news media, he was always referred to as a professor, because you were teaching at the time. And how she found out he was a pastor, I don't know. But she was very relieved, because she thought then we would not come after her other children. So you know what kind of a neighborhood Anthony was raised in, and the culture, eye for an eye. Anthony's sentencing and hearing took place many, many months after the fact. He killed Shannon in June, and it wasn't until the following March that he was finally brought up for sentencing. And we all went back, our parents and Hillary and Chris, her fiance at the time, and we were all there. And as Darold mentioned last night, the courtroom, which was probably half the size of this sanctuary or so, was filled with people in support of us. I was just overwhelmed. There were a lot of media there. This was big news, even in Washington, D.C. And then there was this one little row of people, Anthony's mother and a couple of siblings, and I think another friend or two. I mean, it was like five or six people. It was a very sobering time for me. And we were all seated, and then in comes this little, he seemed little to me compared to what I expected, this little guy with his attorneys, and sat at the table with his head down, almost catatonic. He just acted like he wasn't aware of what was going on. And the judge, of course, brought up all the witnesses. They had a psychologist and the detectives and all that described the crime scene, which was absolutely horrific. And every time they would say to Anthony, "Do you understand the charges? Or do you understand what they're saying?" And I just kind of held my breath, because every time he could have said no, and then it would have gone to trial rather than just this hearing and a sentencing. I really didn't want to go through a trial. And as he sat there and mumbled his, yes, he understood all the time, I call him our attorney. It was actually a state's attorney that represented Shannon. He made a very impassioned plea at the end of all of this, these proceedings, and turned to the judge and to Anthony and said, "This man who has committed this heinous crime deserves to spend the rest of his time in his own private hell." And to that, Anthony looked up and gave him the finger. So that let us know that Anthony was not exactly remorseful. And at that point, you decided, Darold, to not do a victim's witness statement. We didn't want Anthony to know how much control he had had over our lives the last many months. It was just something we didn't want him to have any more control over it. So we chose not to say anything at that time. He was sentenced and taken away in shackles and has spent the rest of his life now in a Maryland prison in Jessup, actually, which is not too far from Washington, D.C. When we would fly into BWI, Baltimore Airport, and drive into the district, then we'd go right by this exit that said Jessup. And finally, at one point, we did... Well, you did before I was there, but we did drive in and sit in the parking lot. I'll talk about that a little bit more later. But Anthony was only 23 when he committed this crime. You know, I was not happy exactly with the idea of him having three square meals a day and access to a gym and entertainment free, you know, all this state paid stuff. And the attorney, I expressed that to our attorney, and he said, "Have you ever been where the lifers are?" I said, "Well, no, I haven't." He said, it's dire. You don't need to think of him as having luxuries. So I don't want him to be deprived. I don't want him to starve in prison or anything like that. But I I also don't want him to have a lot of luxuries, I guess. And even though I've forgiven him, he deserves to suffer the consequences of his choices, is what I believe, and Darold will talk more about that later. Are there things that I have not covered that you want me to?
You said you wanted to say something about the parking lot?
I'm going to do that later in my second section.
Well, my reactions to Anthony in court, to seeing him, were impersonal, actually, and I was grateful for that. I'm an Irishman by heritage, and my parents and I have had ample challenges during my life dealing with my temper. And I always assumed before this happened that if anything should ever hurt a member of my family, whoever did this would need to watch out for me. And I was very grateful for months after Shannon was killed that I only was aware of sadness. I think God rescued me from that part of myself that I wouldn't have been able to cope well with. And even with that obscene gesture in the courtroom, I was still so bathed in my own grief that that didn't preoccupy me. And it was not for several months after that 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 changed. And the change came when a phone call arrived at our place from the state's attorney saying that even though the work, legal work and forensic work had been done very, very carefully, there was still the slight possibility for some appeal on the part of Anthony. And months later, the phone call came saying that Anthony had filed an appeal, that he wanted now to change his plea to not guilty, and he wanted his sentences reduced. And I became instantly furious. This guy who stabbed and slashed Shannon to death now wanted to get out of paying the consequences for doing that. What in the wide world? I was just livid. And in the days and weeks that followed that notice, I began to cope with this turmoil of emotion inside me. My jaw was tense, my stomach was tight, I was miserable. That winter quarter was one of several years that I had been teaching a stress management class. There is a paradox in that, isn't there? It was a graduate course, and we met once a week, and part of our meeting each week was to practice relaxation exercises. So here I was teaching students how to breathe deeply and how that helped relax one's internal organs as well as muscles on the outside. I was teaching students full body relaxation. You kind of pay attention to the muscles at one part of your body and then gradually move up through the rest of your body and just let yourself relax. I teach those things, for goodness sakes, and nothing worked. I could not make it happen for me. I was in this perpetual state of furious frustration. The next quarter, I was teaching a Christian spirituality class, which is a course in which I talk with students and we do some practicing about how to enhance your relationship with God. We talk about prayer and the place of prayer in our devotional life. We talk about how to pick a passage and spend some time then letting that sink into our minds and our awareness. meditating on those words from Scripture, thinking about how God might have a message in that passage for us, how to make that part of our lives, all that prayer, meditation, devotional life stuff, those good exercises for how to live like a close and intimate follower of Jesus. And I was still tied up in knots inside. Early that summer, I went to church one Sabbath morning, and unknown to him, the pastor who spoke that morning talked.
Who was the chaplain that told us about Shannon's death?
His passage was, "They will know you're Christians by the way you love one another." And I had been filled with hatred and resentment for weeks now toward Anthony. It did not take me very long to jump from that text to other statements of Jesus about loving other people, and to land on the one that encouraged us to love our enemies. And to do good to those who hate you and despitefully use you. And I had tried to do that for weeks and weeks, and it hadn't worked. And that Sabbath morning in church, I felt the farthest from God than I had ever felt in my entire life, spiritually bankrupt, so keenly aware of my own failure to live up to this one little thing that Jesus wanted from me, and I could not do it. I mean, I'm a lifelong Christian, a lifelong Adventist Christian. I was a professional Christian, if you will, a pastor who ought to know about this stuff. And it did not work for me. And that dilemma is part of what launched me into a much more serious study about the whole notion of forgiveness. How does one do this when you are so angry for in ways that in many ways seem perfectly legitimate? At least they're understandable, aren't they? I mean, when someone mistreats you or cheats you or lies about you, physically abuses you, assaults you, we ought to be able to be angry about that. And yet, how can we cope with those feelings when Jesus asks us to love those very people who are perpetrators of those things? So, there begins my theoretical discoveries. So let us begin a little classroom exercise here now with some theoretical background and things that we can learn. Is it complicated for me to get this image on a screen, or shall I just turn around once in a while? If it's a complicated thing, I don't mind turning around. A lot has been written about this subject. Thank you very much. A lot has been written about this subject of forgiveness. Have any of you ever Googled or gone to a library and just looked up the word forgiveness or forgiving? Yeah? You'll be overwhelmed with material. In class on campus, I have students each make a presentation toward the end of the quarter. And the most difficult thing these students have to do is to narrow the subject enough that they can make a fairly brief presentation about one tiny aspect of forgiveness, because the volume of material is just absolutely gigantic. Much of it doesn't have anything to do with religion or spirituality. Secular studies have explored the subject so thoroughly now that we can find out a number of very useful and important things. Some of what we discover is that most of the material that we find has to do with forgiving other people. That is to say, it's written from the point of view of the offended person, the victim, if you will, or the survivor of some kind of mistreatment. So, as a person with a grievance, how is it that I go about forgiving other people? That's primary focus of this information. And secondly, most of the material that has been studied and written about in the last about 15 years has to do with the impact of non-forgiveness on us, on the one who is angry or upset. And the truth is, it just eats us up from inside out. It destroys our lives. It's a huge paradox, which some have expressed by saying resentment, non-forgiveness, is like drinking a glass of poison and waiting for the other person to die. It kills us, and it creates all kinds of seemingly strange physiological reactions in us. Backaches, muscle tension, headaches. Of course, relationships get disoriented. Dental cavities are connected to ongoing stress. All kinds of things are related in very concrete ways to the lack of forgiveness. So, for us to learn to forgive, says even the secular literature, is good for the forgiver, not just for the one being forgiven. So, forgive other people as a benefit to you. That's the point. And if you refuse to do that, you, as the victim, are the one who suffers. It seems like a more complicated situation, even from my point of view, for those of us who have a religious background. Because we come into this with the kind of assumptions I carried into church that Sabbath morning. This is an invitation from God to me to be like God. And that rises in my mind out of the Lord's Prayer. I grew up saying that prayer. We know it by heart, don't we? And embedded in the middle of the Lord's Prayer is that phrase, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." And for us to cringe when we say that is a legitimate expression, isn't it? Does this not seem to suggest that we have a duty to forgive other people? And that our prayers to God, for God to forgive us, are contingent on our forgiving of other people. That God expects us to forgive others if we expect God to forgive us. That our responsibility is to forgive those who have offended us in order for God to forgive us for our errors. We're nodding our heads, yeah, that's how we have understood this. That we have work to do before we request God to forgive us. That we act first, and then God responds based on whether we did our job well. That we must succeed before God's willing to help us. That we initiate the process of forgiveness and God reacts to what we have done. Are you getting uncomfortable yet? That our work is to prove to God that we are worthy of Him forgiving us. Now, all of a sudden, we're at the other end. We're saying, whoa, 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 that's not where I intended to go with that. But the assumption of that understanding of the Lord's Prayer leads us inevitably down that road. That unless I forgive those who offend me, God will not forgive me. That's what we think. So that creates a religious dilemma for us who are spiritual people about the whole topic of forgiveness. Because somehow we think it's up to us to accomplish this. Secondly, it means that we have to give up all the selfish little petty insignificant things in life. And if for some reason we're not able to let go of whatever the incidents or the people are who have hurt us, then we are being selfish about this. We're so self-centered that how can we expect God to look graciously on us if we are going to keep waving this flag of somebody hurt me and I'm not going to let go of this and somebody better take care of those people or else? And it doesn't take very long for these religious assumptions in our mind to become a duty. This is a requirement to be a good Christian. That was my assumption. That was my emotional reality when I sat in church that Sabbath morning. My job was to forgive Anthony, and I had not been able to do that. And since I had not been able to do that, God was not able to do for me what He would like to do. Do you see the dilemma in this? It's as if you're abandoned by God because you can't get done what God wants you to do. So our religious assumptions get in our way. Let me back up half a step and tell you that those religious assumptions I had to face and deal with in some way in order to make forgiveness work for me, and I have significantly changed those assumptions now. They are not what they used to be, and before I finish, I'll let you know what I now think and see what you have to respond about that. In addition to the religious assumptions, there are several other things that keep us from dealing with the pain we have in our lives. One of those is we don't like to face reality. We've had several of you comment about Barbara and me resurrecting this story about Shannon and describing as clearly as we do in our own minds and are willing to share with you what happened to her. See, we often ask ourselves, don't we, wouldn't it be easier just to forget about all of that? Just to ignore it, let it go away. Pretend that it never happened. Because we don't like to face reality. The truth is miserable. This world is a cruel, unhappy, unfair place. And we would like to be able to escape that. So why dredge up all of that reality? So that's a problem in the process of forgiveness. Because if you don't face reality, you can't forgive it. Secondly, we have sadness about that. We wish things had been different. If you were a child who was beaten by a parent, you wish that had never happened to you. If you were a person who was sexually assaulted by someone stronger or more powerful than you, you hate what they took away from you. If you were taken advantage of in a business deal or betrayed by a former friend those hurts are horrible. And you have deep sadness about that. So our regrets bother us. And we don't like to admit the bad feelings we have either, do we? I put the strongest word possible here just to shock us all. We sometimes talk about being irritated or bothered by things. But unbridled, those feelings would often escalate, wouldn't they, to anger, to very intense, volatile expressions of that anger, and ultimately to rage. And we don't want to admit that those things are there. So our inclination often is to avoid reality, to avoid our sadness and regrets, and to avoid the rage that all of that stirs up in us. We just would rather pretend it didn't happen at all. And that prevents the process of forgiveness. Right at the end, she says, I don't know what happened. You know, research proves to us that anger hijacks our brain. They can literally track. I can't get this to advance, so I think you'll have to do that for me back there. There we go, thanks. That it literally hijacks the brain patterns, so that we can't use the frontal decision-making lobe in our brain when we get so angry. So no wonder we say, you're so upset you can't think clearly. It's absolutely true. Yeah. So those things make forgiveness very difficult. Avoiding reality, the wish not to face the sadness and losses we have had, and rage, and finally, revenge. Our determination to get back at somebody else, to make them suffer like we suffered, to let them know how miserable they have made us, to make them accountable for what they did to us. All of those things capture us and chain us to the very people we would like to be able to let go of. We become slaves to those people. Another Irish connection here for you. There's an old Irish toast, I'm told, that kind of gets at the notion of revenge. In case you don't want to do the revenging yourself, you can wish that somebody else might take care of it. And so you toast, "Here's to my enemies' enemies." And you hope other people will get back at them. Well, my word, don't we see evidence enough in our world of generations and centuries, millennia, of conflict between people that illustrate that revenge never ends, never ends. I had someone tell us, after hearing us talk about the idea of revenge one time, they told us about a movie that was describing a woman who grew up in a fictitious country in Africa. It was during the time she was a child, during the time of the uprisings, and the indigenous people were taking over the country. This young girl's parents were killed by one of the men who later became the president of this newly formed African country. She escaped, came to the United States, became an interpreter at the United Nations. The president of this country, who was responsible for her parents' death, scheduled a trip to the United Nations and was going to make an address to the General Assembly. In preparation for that visit, the Secret Service in the U.S. discovered that there was a plot to assassinate this African leader while he was here in the U.S. And because of her family background, she became an immediate suspect in this plot. So in this scene, she has been asked by a Secret Service agent whether this is true, whether she may be part of this intention to assassinate the visiting president while he's here. So what you'll see in this little clip is a monologue, a story of hers that she tells about the idea of revenge. That's not a bad Hollywood line, is it? Vengeance is a lazy form of grief. Yeah. So all of this brought to my mind then some discoveries about what forgiveness is not that broke down some of my assumptions about what would have been necessary in order to forgive Anthony in my case. One of those is that forgiveness is not forgetting. If you forgot all of the bad incidents, what kind of a world would we live in if you ignored every evil that was perpetrated on other people? We'd live in a chaotic place, wouldn't we? So one cannot forget about those things which have happened, or it would simply be ignoring them. And we've already seen that that just doesn't help. In the rest of John 21, which I didn't keep you long enough to work through with you this morning, in the rest of John 21, do you remember how Jesus restores Peter to that circle? You remember that three times he asks him, "Peter, do you love me?" And he didn't ask him in a quiet little private discussion. He asked in front of everybody else. This had been a public betrayal, and it needed to be a public reclamation. And on the third time that John records that Jesus asked Peter this question, it says Peter, one translation says grieved. Peter was grieved that Jesus would ask him again. It was humiliating to him that Jesus would keep asking. Why did he want to do that? Jesus was not forgetting what happened, was he? He was wanting to raise that incident up so clearly in their minds that when it was forgiven, it could be lived with. The reality is never forgotten, but we can accommodate that sad memory into our community now. So for us, I think that suggests that we don't forget the bad things that happened to us. We learn how to face that reality in a clear enough way that it doesn't paralyze us anymore. That we live in spite of those things, not in ignorance of them. So, forgiveness is not forgetting. Nor does it mean that what happened was all right, that you condone bad behavior. You don't have to say, "Well, it wasn't so bad after all, that you stole from me, or that you misrepresented me, or that you assaulted me, or insulted me." No, you don't condone the bad behavior in order to forgive it. And you don't excuse them either. "Oh, only I understand that you were under stress right then, and so you didn't have all of your faculties." We hold them responsible for what has taken place. This one is a little harder for some of us as Christians to cope with. But it seems to me that part of the reality of our human life is that in this world, reconciliation is not always possible. You might have to think about that one for a while, and when we have some questions afterward, I'd be happy to have you make some speeches on the other side of this. But I have come to the place where I believe that sometimes it is impossible for two people who have been so hurt by one another that it's humanly impossible for them to deal with the hurt as if they had overcome it or as if it had never happened. I go about this in a little different way than some. I think it's possible for us to let go of the anger and resentment that is there, but still not expect ourselves to accommodate working with or being with those people who were perpetrators in the first place. So, for example, I remember visiting with an adult woman who was sexually abused as a child by her uncle, repeatedly over a fairly lengthy period of years. It is impossible for her to include that uncle in family reunions without it bringing back all of those horrible memories to her. So she addresses that now by, instead of saying that blankety blankety blank 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 is never going to be in my presence again, rather than blaming him, she acknowledges her own limitations and says, I can't cope with being around Uncle so-and-so. So for his sake, in case I should lash out at him, and for my sake, because of what it stirs up in me, the two of us just can't be together. Do you remember the Bible story about Paul and Barnabas and their irreconcilable differences over Barnabas's nephew, John Mark, who was going to go along on the missionary journey, and the first time he got homesick and needed his mommy so bad that they had to send him home early? I'm making up that part of the story. I don't know what the real reason was. But I suspect that might be it, huh? Whatever it was, when they get ready to go out on the second journey and Barnabas wants to take John Mark again, Paul says, pretty strong terms, absolutely not. I am not taking that little squirt with us again. He messed us up last time. He can stay home. And the division was so sharp that there was no reconciliation there. What was the result of that irreconcilable difference between those two men? Doubled the number of missionary groups, just like that. So the consequence was not all bad, was it? It produced some good in spite of human limitations. I think we need to accept our limitations and say, apart from some miracle of God or transformation at the end of human life, at the beginning of eternity, I just can't cope with being in the presence of that person. So if those things, if forgiveness is not all of those things, here are some things I've come to think forgiveness is now. We face reality. And for Barbara and me, that's what retelling our story is all about. It is coming back again to the truth. Not trying to avoid what happened. Reminds me of another poem. Again, by that same writer as last night. The memories come back. She says it like this. Time does not bring relief. You all have lied who told me time would ease me of my pain. I miss him in the weeping of the rain. I want him at the shrinking of the tide. The old snows melt from every mountainside, and last year's bitter loving must remain heaped on my heart, and my old thoughts abide. There are 100 places where I fear to go, so with his memory they brim, and entering with relief some quiet place where never felt his foot or shone his face, I say, There is no memory of him here. And so stand stricken, so remembering him. So even when we think we have forgotten, we remember that we forgot. The circle perpetuates itself. And the memories of those incidences often bring up the need to kind of refresh the forgiveness process for us as well. For us to assume that having forgiven someone 10 years ago will take care of it for the rest of our lives is a bit naive. Because when the memories come up, the hurt is there again, the resentment resurfaces, and we need to go through that process again of letting go of those things, and we'll talk a little bit more concretely about how we found it helpful to do that. Does that make sense? So, the very fact that you're feeling angry or remembering an incident is not indication that you didn't forgive them. It's just an invitation to do it again. What did Paul say about his relationship to Jesus? I die daily, over and over and over. I reaffirm this decision, this commitment. We confront the truth. We don't step around it. We don't avoid the reality that's there. We deal with it as directly as it's possible for us to do that. In some cases, that's impossible. So for us, we're not able to confront Anthony directly. We just have to do that in our own minds. For some of you, there may be, for one reason or another, that the perpetrator is unavailable or unwilling to participate in that kind of facing of what happened. But that doesn't keep you from dealing with the issue itself. You can do that on your own if confronting the truth with that other person isn't feasible. This one sometimes bothers Christians. I think we should expect consequences for what happened. The person who beat me as a child will never be the same in my eyes. The person who raped me will never recover whatever respect I may have had for them before. The person who stole from me should not expect me to trust them over and over and over again. Eroding the confidence of a relationship takes periods of time to restore and sometimes is impossible. Those consequences are a natural result of human choice, and we ought not to pretend as if there were no consequences for those bad things. But forgiveness does suggest my need and ability to let go of the anger and resentment I harbor inside me. And once I do that, that changes everything. It is where we started out. It is for my sake, as the one who is offended, that I am forgiving the offender. And it may not be of any help. They may not even be aware of that. But for me, it makes a huge difference. And I want to find that reality for myself, whether or not the perpetrator ever knows. Let me back up and think about this in another way now. Barbara and I have been to more than one prison to talk about this subject of forgiveness. And particularly among those kinds of populations, forgiveness is a two-edged sword. That is to say, They are there paying the consequences of having done something grievous to someone or something else. But many of them have also been mistreated themselves in one way or another. So they know what it's like to experience grievances, and they know what it's like to be the perpetrator. I believe these same kinds of definitions apply as well to perpetrators as they do to victims. So think of yourself as one who has hurt someone else, said an angry thing or made a hurtful statement, maybe more egregious than that. Some way you have been hurtful to someone else. And the way for you to be able to forgive yourself would include facing the truth of what happened, to confront that part of yourself, not run away or dodge it, not pretend that it never happened, but to deal with that reality and let the reality of the pain you've inflicted on somebody else so permeate you that you expect some consequences to that. Have you damaged relationships so much that in this life you may not be able to recover the kind of intimacy that existed in that friendship or relationship before? Anticipate that there are some ongoing realities here. And then find a way to let go of the anger and resentment towards you. I sat in church that Sabbath morning, absolutely shattered, when I realized that I could not do what Jesus asked me to do. I could not forgive my enemies. And this wasn't just because I got upset with my sister because she took my toy when we were children, or that she was trying to boss me around in the playground. This was the real core of who I am. I was an angry, resentful, vengeance-filled human being. At the core of myself, I was hateful. And I was miserable with that, because it made me feel way too much like I assumed would describe Anthony Robinson in his cell in Jessup. And to think of myself as estranged from God, like Anthony was, to in that way be as morally bankrupt as the man who slaughtered our daughter was humiliating to me. I had never faced myself so intensely as a perpetrator as I did in that moment in church. And it was very few seconds after that dawned on me that Paul's statement in Romans 5 came clearly to my mind. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Very seldom would one man die for another, though if it was really good man, maybe somebody might be willing to die. But God shows his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. When that dawned on me that Sabbath morning, it changed everything for me. And I realized that the knot I'd been carrying in my stomach for weeks now was gone. that my hands were relaxed. They weren't clenched in a fist. That my jaw was relaxed. And by the time we sang the closing hymn that Sabbath morning and were walking out of church, I recognized that a long-held resentment I had toward a ministerial colleague who I thought had misrepresented me was gone. For me, what that taught me was that God can do things for me that I can't do for myself. We all know that, but I had not experienced it in that way before. And to experience God's love for me when I had harshly faced the reality of my own sinfulness made all the difference for me. It was no longer that my anger was focused on Anthony. It was that my sadness and regret was shining a bright light on the bad part of who I am. And to let God love me when I most hated myself was the key to that transformation. So I no longer talk now about forgiving myself. That seems, as a phrase, an internal impossibility. Because if I try to forgive myself, it means I'm already aware of something I regret, that I feel grief or guilt about that. And who am I to say that the very thing that is distressing to me about myself is something now I'm going to forgive? I am much better impressed with saying that rather than forgiving myself, what I need to practice doing is accepting God's forgiveness of me. And I don't forgive myself. I acknowledge who God is and what God has done, and that transforms me. And that brings us to the text I'm looking for that the musicians chose this morning in Colossians 3. Wonderful text. If you have something against your brother, this is just practical home church advice from the Apostle Paul, who's writing to his friends in Colossae, saying, listen, when you get upset with each other, treat each other well. Forgive one another as Christ forgave us. So you've already been forgiven by God. The model is already there. Just enact that on behalf of one another. God acts first. He did that already. While we were still sinners, He did that. Accept that reality. God initiated it. You accept it, and it changes everything. So when I carry that then back to the Lord's Prayer, how does that fit? Are Paul and Matthew's memory, well, and Luke does the same thing with the Lord's Prayer. Are the apostles' memories different from that of Paul? Paul saying, God forgave us first, and you ought to forgive one another because of what God did. And the Lord's Prayer says, no, no, you forgive first, then God will forgive you. Is it a conflict there? No, I say to myself. I believe that the Bible is all inspired by the same God. So how can I understand these two things to be pointing in the same direction? I talked with some biblical scholar friends to check this idea out, and it seems to fit. Jesus often described what sounds like a requirement, but is actually a simple statement of reality. Love your neighbor as you love yourself, for example. because he knows that all of us feel protective of ourselves. If somebody attacks us, we defend ourselves. We eat so that we can stay healthy. We take care of ourselves. So since you do love yourself in that way, we'll love other people in the same way. It's a statement of truth, not a demand or a requirement. If you took the phrase in the Lord's Prayer that way, how would it sound to you? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. In fact, to the degree that I accept God's forgiveness of me, I am able to forgive other people. To the degree that I am hesitant or reject God's forgiveness of me, I tend to be hesitant to forgive other people. To the degree that I have experienced God loving me when I hated myself, I can share the experience of God's love through me of other people. So if that becomes a description of how human beings function, it's no longer a requirement, it's simply a prediction of the truth. You've got to accept what God's done for you in order to be able to forgive other people. Luke, in the 24th chapter of his book, talks about the conversation of the disciples with Jesus on the road to Emmaus. And one of the things he tells them is that this Jesus had been resurrected to share repentance and forgiveness of sins. And then he says to the disciples, you are witnesses of these things. You share what happened to you, that's all. You just tell the story of how it happened in your life. You open yourself to receive God, and God's gift to you comes back to you. So for me, this is how I have found it much more plausible to be a forgiving person. Face the truth, experience God's forgiveness of me, and then I naturally and instinctively share that forgiveness with other people. And it comes as a natural response to who God is in my life rather than as an accomplishment, some effort I exert to do what God demands or requires of me to do. So this is what I went through. I let my own guilt overwhelm me and let God trigger through the Spirit my repentance for who I am and bathe in the unfathomable love of God for me when I hate myself. And that changes it all. So that's Darold's kind of rational process of forgiveness. Barbara's is different from that, so let me have you hear what she has to say about that subject, and then we'll field comments and questions from you.
February 20, 2016. My dear Shannon, several years ago, your dad and I were first asked to talk about forgiveness in the context of your murder. Since we vowed to tell our story whenever someone asked, here I am again. You love to talk, so this seems fitting and appropriate, a way to honor you. As a communications major in college, you seem to come up with the most clever ideas and words to express yourself. I'm not that creative, but writing you a letter helps me, even though you'll never hear nor read it. When Anthony Robinson got into your apartment on that Sunday, I can't even imagine the sheer terror you must have felt. I want to believe that God kept you from feeling the pain and humiliation as Anthony brutally killed you. The detective said you were rendered unconscious very early on, and I choose to believe that was true. You'd be glad that our dear friend John Kress was the one who told us of your death. He was so kind about it. He, Henning, Stephen Payne, your old boss, John Brunt and Liz Heisler stayed with us for days as we sorted out the logistics of your service, who to ask to serve as your pallbearers, do the music, and take part in your funeral at the Walla Walla College Church, your church, where you served as a deaconess and student elder. The Maryland police and detectives worked very hard on your case. They found your prayer journal beside your bed and read it. Your silent witness made them determined to find your killer. Amazingly, Anthony was found and arrested early Tuesday. At first, he denied any connection, but later he pleaded guilty to first-degree murder, attempted sex offense, and armed robbery. Your neighbors identified him as going in and out of your apartment that fateful Sunday, Father's Day, and your Grandpa Messenger's birthday. Since you were moving soon to start your new job in Idaho, the neighbors thought Anthony must have bought some of your stuff so you wouldn't have to move it. The impact of losing you, my firstborn, was, still is, and ever will be enormous. The fact that you died such a violent death made it almost more than I could bear. Many times, I thought I would literally die of a broken heart. However, as you always did, I put my trust in God and leaned heavily on Him. He also knows what it's like to lose a child by violence. How could I forgive Anthony, this man who violated you? I can't take any credit for not hating him. Jesus gave me that forgiveness early on. The one I hate is Satan. I was and am so angry at him, I felt guilty at first. You might get a chuckle out of that. Is it wrong to hate Satan? In some ways, it was easy for me to forgive Anthony. Perhaps I wanted to explain why he might have done this horrific deed because it would be easier for me to cope. Maybe he was on drugs when he attacked you, though by the time he was found, that couldn't be proved. Why wasn't he celebrating Father's Day with his dad? There was never a mention of a father in his life. He'd been in a mental hospital, and he made terrible life choices. Someone like that triggers pity from me, not hatred. Oh, I hate what he did to you, and I believe he should face the consequences of his actions. Life in prison without the possibility of parole isn't too harsh a punishment in my mind. Nevertheless, I have forgiven him. For me, the real test of forgiveness came when I felt convicted to pray for Anthony. How could I pray for someone who killed you? But Jesus prayed for those who were nailing him to the cross, and he taught us to love our enemies and those who hurt us. So I asked Jesus to make me willing to pray for Anthony. But it took many months before I could do that. However, thanks to my Savior's persistent nudging, I've been able to pray that Anthony will learn about Christ and his forgiveness, a gift much more important than my forgiveness. After all, Jesus died for Anthony just as much as he died for you and me. And I know you'd want us to forgive your killer. Once convinced that something was right, you let nothing stand in your way to follow those convictions. Thank you for modeling that. When I saw the prison where Anthony is incarcerated, those brick buildings surrounded by rows of razor wire, I sobbed with grief again. My heart ached with loneliness for you. But I also wondered about Anthony. then only about 31 years old. What must it be like to spend every day of your life locked up? Does he ever feel sorry or guilty for what he did to you? Will he ever know he's forgiven? Does that idea even cross his mind? I want to remember that forgiveness is a gift from God. He knows that hatred and anger only hurt us, not those who perpetrated the harm. I need to remember that I can't do anything, including forgiving Anthony, to make myself good enough to save. I must remember to stay connected to Jesus so that I can see you again, my dear Shani. We know your life wasn't perfect, but you were certainly headed in the right direction. Someday you'll be surprised to learn that your death has helped others. Perhaps you'll meet someone in heaven who says, "You don't know me, but I'm here because of you." I can imagine you saying, "See, Mom, it was worth it." Until then, I'll keep on praying for Anthony, for myself, and for all our family and friends. Sharing our story here in McMinnville reminds me of your dearest friend, Jennifer. She taught school here when she moved back to the Northwest. You two were such soulmates and could have had a wonderful time living close to each other. Jen still regularly keeps in touch, shares her heart about missing you, and gives us gifts that reminds us of the love you shared of all things Disney. Her son even calls us Grandma Barbara and Grandpa Darold. Oh, why did this horrific tragedy have to cut your friendship short? When I watch the news clips of a body bag being carried out of your apartment, it seems so surreal. Can that possibly be our girl? That only happens to other people. Sadly, sin happens, and your death is a small part of the huge sin problem everyone faces. We just have to make a choice about how we'll deal with it. I'm choosing to keep asking Jesus to hold my hand as we continue to walk through this valley. When we visit your grave, I hate leaving you at Mount Hope Cemetery, but one day it will be a glorious place when, as Paul wrote in Corinthians, all of you who died in Christ will rise first. I love and miss you so much, and I'll see you then, Mom.
Let's pray. Lord, as we bow before you at the end of this presentation, in this series, during this yesterday and today, we just thank you, Lord, for the beauty of your love and your care that so much is there and is everlasting, never changes. And even though we change and we are fickle, one day we're feeling good and we're laughing, and the next day we're down in the dumps and we're crying and we're mad and we're angry, we're upset. Thank you that you understand our human frailty. And Lord, as we deal with all this stuff, thank you that you have answers, that you want to draw us close to you and say, just hold us tight and say, "My son, my daughter, it's okay. I am here. I'm with you. And I promise to be with you until the end." Hasten that end, Lord. Usher in your new day of life eternal. We long for it. We pray your special blessing on the Darold and Barbara, as they continue to share their gift and their ministry to those that need it. Give them the strength, give them the inner sense of purpose and fulfillment and joy and meaning as you lead them and guide them to be a blessing to those around us in this dark and terrible world that sometimes just hurts us so much. And so, Lord, as we go out from this place, make us this week agents of healing, agents of restoration, agents of reconciliation, and invitation come unto me, and I will give you rest. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming. God bless you in this week.